One of the lesser known aspects of Holy Communion is the power of proclaiming the Lord's death. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 26, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes." Now you might ask me, "Pastor Stefeni, what about the Lord's death are we proclaiming, and to whom are we proclaiming it?" Well, Paul also said in Colossians 2, verse 15, having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. So when we remember Jesus' death, we are also proclaiming to the principalities and powers that they have been disarmed. They've been defeated because he has triumphed over them. Now, Jesus told us to have communion often, so there must be something powerful about it. And because of that, I want to say to you that I know that this was last week's lesson, and we went over it already, but the Lord has led me to bring it again and drive the points home. So something he wants you to understand about it that I didn't get across last week. All right. So, well, like I said, Jesus told us to have communion often, and there has to be something powerful about it, because would you think that he would make us do something often without having our blessing in mind? No. Those who believe in the power of the perfect sacrifice on the cross know that his blessings of health, wholeness, and preservation actually abound at his table. So once you're a believer, you are a priest. You're of the royal priesthood. You'll find that in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. So you can partake of the Lord's Supper and even minister it to others. All right? You don't need a pastor to do it. Really, you don't. In the church, we pastors do the administering of it because we are the spiritual authority over the people, and there must be order in how we conduct things. But outside the church, you as a royal priest from the royal priesthood are qualified to partake on your own. Do as Jesus said, have it often. How often? Well, is that your question? Of course, as often as you need to. It depends on how much you want his health and wholeness. Look, we have a tendency as people, let me try to explain this a little bit. We have a tendency as people to slide down that slippery slope backwards. In other words, we're going along fine. Everything seems good. We've got a handle on our health and wholeness. And then suddenly we are struck with a symptom and we start falling backwards. We start giving into it and thinking that we are sick, or that we might we're becoming sick. So what do? When you take Holy Communion, you are reminding the principalities they've been defeated and they get their hands off of you. But you're also saying, you know what? I need this right now to remind me that I've been healed already because of Holy Communion, because of who Jesus is on the cross and what he did for me on the cross and who I am in Christ. And it puts you right back in the position you needed to be in. It helps you thwart that fiery dart that was aimed at you. So if you need it every 5 minutes, then do it. And especially if you've been under attack, say you're in a hospital or something, and for some sort of really drastic stuff, you know, then you need to do it often. As often as your mind starts slipping and running downhill, you need to have Holy Communion to bring you right back up and keep you from falling. It'll hold you up. Now, I'm not saying that you have to partake every day, but if you're sick or you sustain a debilitating condition, I really recommend that you take communion daily, maybe even two or three times a day. Because, you know, I can say this. I even suggest you become radical. Take it like medicine, three times a day if necessary. You know what? You'll get radical results. Now, some of you may think I'm extreme, but let me tell you something. Those who trust in God and in his son's perfect work at Calvary are extreme. We are extremely blessed. So if for no other reason, partake of Holy Communion often, since it's God's channel of health and wholeness for you. You know, it's his positioning you and keeping you in the proper position to receive. God has made it truly easy for us, his people, to walk in divine health, my friends. All we have to do is come to his table, put your faith in his broken body for your healing, and partake. It's so simple and extremely powerful. That's why the devil has tried to steal this truth from the church by making Christians believe that they shouldn't partake. And he does this by making you believe that you're unworthy to come to the Lord's table. This is a lie from the pit of hell. The reason Christians believe this is due to a misinterpretation of 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 29 through 30. Listen to this. "For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep." Now, I was one of those who was under this misconception of the word. I shared that same wrong teaching with all of you. Before partaking, I would tell you to remember that scripture that it tells us to eat and drink unworthily with unforgiveness in our hearts is to eat and drink damnation to our souls. Well, when the Lord began giving me the in-depth teaching on grace years ago, he showed me the truth in this. He showed me with the scriptures how I, among thousands of others, had fallen into the trap of misunderstanding that scripture. He showed me his truth in the scripture, and I am now here explaining it to you so that you will not miss his true meaning. When I was first born again, I was told not to come to the Lord's table with sin in my life. That sin was, as I said, unforgiveness. For years, I understood that. It became a large part of my personal theology. I went to Bible colleges and was not taught any differently. They only confirmed the misinterpretation of the scripture. So, to clarify and show you the truth, let's take a look at what it means to partake unworthily. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 27 through 29. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat of this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. All right, first we have to look at the way the words are used here. I'll just say this. Unworthily describes the action of eating and drinking. It's not describing the person who is eating and drinking. Now, I want to go back here because we might as well have, the way I was taught, when it says, for he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, might as well left off not discerning the Lord's body, because we just got through saying if you're to have unforgiveness in your heart, you're eating and you go to take Holy Communion, you're damning yourself to hell. All right. So looking at the way the words are used here, unworthily describes the action of eating and drinking. It's not describing the person who's eating and drinking. So Paul wasn't saying that you're an unworthy person, so don't partake. The Lord showed me that the church hasn't rightly divided the word here. They have turned something, a major something, that was meant to be a blessing into a curse. Now watch this. All of us who came to the Lord's table unworthily were made worthy by his blood. You see? It's Jesus' death that qualifies us to partake at all. So what Paul was saying is that we shouldn't partake in an unworthy manner. So to understand what it means to partake in an unworthy manner, look at the rest of verse 29. You will conclude that if you fail to discern or understand the significance of the Lord's body, you are eating and drinking in an unworthy manner. Now, I've explained that we must look at who the Bible's speaking to, what is being said, and how it applies to us when we read Scripture. So, you have to understand then that Paul was speaking to the Corinthians, who partook unworthily because they didn't recognize that the broken body of the Lord was meant to bring them health and wholeness. And by treating the Holy Communion as a ritual, they missed out on blessings. They didn't understand the significance of the bread. They didn't know why they were partaking. And this is what it means to partake unworthily. The manner in which we partake will determine whether we experience the benefits of the Lord's body, his vibrancy, his divine health and wholeness. All right. In doing it that way, we have robbed ourselves of the life-giving effects of the bread of his, at his table. Let me show you one more proof. All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 20 through 22. Therefore, when you come together in one place, it is not to eat the Lord's supper. For in eating, each one takes his own supper ahead of others, and one is hungry and another drunk. What do you not have? What do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Sorry, I had to get it right. Paul was giving them a good tongue lashing, wasn't he? Because when they came to the Lord's table, those who were hungry rushed for their turn in front of others. And then there was others that guzzled the wine until they became drunk. So Paul was not saying that if you have sin or unforgiveness in your heart and in your life, you can't partake. He was telling us to partake in the correct manner, which is to recognize that the Lord's body was broken so that ours can be made whole. Do not take the Lord's supper because you are hungry. If you are hungry, eat at home first. Here's another thing I need to share with you. I was in a church situation where I shared a church house, a building, with another ministry. That minister did the Sunday service, and that was fine because I was a school and I was a teacher. So my thing was, it was two different businesses put together, even though it was the Lord's business. All right. he did the Sunday service, and he would buy a loaf of challah bread, which was fine. It's a beautiful loaf, tastes good, and put it out. And then he did what we call Holy Communion in tincture. That means that a person breaks off a hunk of bread, and they dip it in the wine, and then eat it. All right, so that they don't drink out of the same cup. All right, so that's the way he did Holy Communion in tincture, and there's nothing wrong with that. Absolutely nothing wrong with it. But the congregation was small enough that a loaf of challah bread is like maybe 22, no, maybe longer than that. Let me see. Maybe 20 inches long. And it's thick, you know, so that when you start breaking off the top, you get into the middle of the bread part, and then you get down to the crust on the bottom, that kind of thing. It's so, and it's lovely. It's delicious. All right. People would go forward. That's the way we did line up. We'd go forward, break off a piece of bread, dip it in tincture, in the wine, and then eat it. Okay. Nothing wrong with that, except that Holy Communion was not explained. So we all lined up like little zombies and went forward and broke off. And he said to us, take as much as you need. Okay. I see the error now, and I'm not condemning the man. It's just that he was lack of understanding as well. I went along with it because I had lack of understanding. All right. But remember the woman, the Samaritan woman at the well? Jesus came up and said, give me a drink of water. And I'm paraphrasing here, and I'll probably touch on this a little bit later because I want you to understand it. But this is important, so I'll probably say it twice. Remember the woman? And she wanted her daughter healed, so she said, heal my daughter. And he said, pour me some water. I came for the Jews. I'm really paraphrasing here. I came for the Jews. They're the chosen ones, and that's the way it is. And she said, why would I want to give, you don't want to give the children's bread to the dogs. All right. Now, the children's bread, the Jews were the chosen people, so everybody else were just like dogs. They were just curs, you know, nothing. You're beneath me. And even though Jesus didn't say it with animosity or anything like that, he said, why would we give the give the food to the dogs? And the woman said, even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the children's table. All right. Think about a toast crumb. When you make toast in the toaster and you butter your toast, and then you look at the mess that you made, and what is it? It's all crumbs. Little tiny specks of pieces of bread. Even the tiniest crumb that falls from the table, the dogs will lick up, won't they? Sure. That's what Jesus was saying, and that's what the woman was saying. He said, hey, those don't give them the children's bread. And she said, but even those crumbs that fall from the table, the children's table, the dogs will eat. And they'll gain the benefit of. They're gaining, and if you're going to let them eat the crumbs, then by golly, give them the benefit of it. And what's the benefit? Health and wholeness. And Jesus said, you're right. Okay. And he healed her. And because of what the woman said, the daughter was healed right then. Now, I said that to say this. It doesn't matter how big the piece of bread is. So you don't have to run up, take half a loaf, and stuff it in your mouth. You're running the risk of eating that only because you're hungry and you didn't eat breakfast. Okay. I'm not saying don't eat the bread that way. I don't say don't eat four or five crumbs as they get past you and that have been little cubes of bread, if that's what you need. But what I am saying is discern what you're doing. It only takes a crumb. If the plate came by you and all there was a crumb, that's okay. Take it. Because that crumb has just as much healing power as the piece of bread that was taken before it. Okay? Paul was telling the Corinthians, my friends, to discern the power of the Lord's broken body. He was teaching us that if we fail to discern the body, we should not partake because we're not claiming by faith what Jesus has done for us. And that's what that woman at the well was saying to Jesus. Hey, even a toast crumb, even a little piece of crumb off on the floor, the dogs will eat it and they'll be healed. So what's the matter with you healing my child? I don't care. Consider me a dog. I'll eat the crumbs because I too will gain the benefit. Okay. So then, by failing to do so, by failing to discern, all right, that the bread properly, that it's the healing power of God, it's his body, we're making his work on the cross ineffective and powerless as far as we're concerned. You see, Vine's expository dictionary has this to say about partaking unworthily. In the New Testament, it's unworthily is anaxius. New Testament 371 is used in 1 Corinthians 11:27 of partaking of the Lord's Supper unworthily, i.e. treating it as a common meal, the bread and the cup as common things, not apprehending their solemn symbolic import. So Jesus wants us to take the bread and believe that his body was broken so that our bodies can be made well. And when we do, we are partaking worthily. When you come to his table and release your faith in the Lord's body, in that crumb of bread, that piece of bread, that particle of bread, that particle of food, you will receive the benefits of healing, health, and wholeness. And you will be strong, healthy, and live long. So, we've been talking about understanding what it means to discern the Lord's body, right? Regarding communion. And we have talked about the possible misconceptions that people get under because of a variety of church doctrines that we pick up like a rolling stone as we go from church to church on our journey to find Jesus in a church home. We're going to look further at what it means to examine oneself. First, we have to understand the context of Paul's statement. He's addressing the issue of eating and drinking unworthily. So it follows that he was telling the Corinthians that they should examine themselves to see if they were eating and drinking in a worthy manner. Nowhere does it say that he told them to examine themselves to see if there was sin in their lives. Let's take a look. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 27 through 29. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner, eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. Now, looking at that passage again, it is clear that Paul is saying that a man should examine himself to see if he's eating and drinking worthily so as not to eat and drink judgment to himself. Amen? It is so simple, but preachers have for so long made Christians fearful and sin conscious. He just wants us to be sun conscious. He just wants us to examine ourselves to see if we are putting our faith in his son's work on the cross for us. So what does it mean to drink judgment to yourself? Well, this judgment does not mean God's anger or wrath. I used to think that, but God showed me the truth. In some circles, people still believe that the judgment here refers to God sending them to hell. That is an incorrect interpretation. The Greek word used here is krima, which means divine sentence. When Adam sinned against God, a divine sentence fell on the human race. Weakness, sickness, and death are some of the effects of that divine sentence. As long as we are here on this earth, our bodies are subject to the aging process, which is part of that divine sentence. All our bodies are decaying every day. Our brain cells are dying daily as well. The Holy Communion is God's solution for us to offset the decay. Even your friends will see the results. They will begin to ask you things like, why you seem to look so much younger? You just seem to never age. Now, one day when we get to heaven, we will have brand new bodies that never grow old, never tire out, and never look bad. And meanwhile, the Lord's Supper is how God helps us offset this process of aging and walking in divine health. Every time you partake, you are reversing the effects of the curse or divine judgment in your body. You understand? Well, right now, if you desire to come into and dwell in the miraculous presence of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, if you desire to be in Christ and avail yourself of his marvelous wisdom and power, you must give your life to him. It's simple and pain-free, and in just a moment, I'm going to give you that opportunity.
Upon this broken ground, sick and lame, to set the captive free, to break the prisoner's chains. Well, I'd still be in the dark, grappling for the door, longing for some way, somehow. But love came for me, love rescued me, love called my name, love took my place, sweet Lamb of God.
Beloved, to come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, to become a child of God, sincerely with heartfelt repentance, come before the Lord with a contrite heart, which means a crushed, crippled, and broken heart, and pray a similar prayer to this one. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, I come to you as a sinner and surrender my life to you. I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you died for me and set me free for all eternity from all my sin. I believe that you rose from the dead and sit at the right hand of God the Father. Take over my life and cleanse me of all unrighteousness. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. I renounce the devil and all sin. Lord, I receive from you the gift of righteousness, total forgiveness of all my sins, past, present, and future, divine health, wholeness, and restoration, your protection, direction, your provision, your peace, and the gift of everlasting life. I'm yours. Come into my heart and take over my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you believed that prayer that you just prayed with me and meant it when you asked Jesus to come in and take over your life, then you're saved. Welcome to God, the family of God. Now, just a minute. In just a minute, I'm going to play a song for you. But first, I want to go over the lyrics with you so you'll open your eyes of your heart to see and gain knowledge and understanding of what our partaking of Holy Communion really means. Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us, and we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. So we share in his bread of life, and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace, a around the table of the king. The body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, torn for you, eat and remember, the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. So we share in this bread of life and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of love around the table of the king. The blood that cleanses every stain of sin, shed for you, drink and remember. He drained death's cup that all may enter in to receive the life of God. So we share in this bread of life and we drink of his sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of grace around the table of the king. And so with thankfulness and faith, we rise to respond and to remember our call to follow in the steps of Christ as his body here on earth. As we share in his suffering, we proclaim Christ will come again and we joy in the feast of heaven around the table of the king. All right, let's listen to this.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. And we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. So we share in this bread. Sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the king. The body of our Savior Jesus Christ tore. That healed the death that brings us life, paid the price to make us one. Love the King.
of the wonderful things that we receive from taking Holy Communion is healing of our bodies and minds. If you have issues with those who take Holy Communion and don't receive their healing through it, know that that issue is rooted in lack of knowledge. You know, we must prepare before taking Holy Communion. And before I explain discerning the body of Christ again for you, I want you to understand something about our use of the bread and wine, or juice, as the elements of the covenant. You see, Jesus and his disciples had bread and wine on the table when they shared the Last Supper. The meal had come to an end, and there was still some food that was left on the table, some bread and some wine. These elements, all right, or these items were familiar to all of them. Now, because those particular items, the bread and the wine, were used to draw the picture Jesus wanted them to see, that's why we use bread and juice or wine. But remember that it doesn't matter what food items you use. Use what's available to you. It's perfectly acceptable. Why? Because we pray over the items, sanctifying them as the body and the blood of Christ. So what I want you to see in this is that what you need is to believe that they become that body and blood. Now, the Word of God tells us that the first thing we must do is discern the body of Christ. We do that by acknowledging that the bread or whatever food item you're using as the body of Christ is the vibrancy of the life of Jesus, his supernatural healing and wholeness, his attributes, his statutes, that because of his body and blood, you're supernaturally have become bone of Jesus' bone and flesh of Jesus' flesh, that you are now filled with his perfection and power, completely healed, completely made whole, completely restored to divine health. You could think of it as medicine, a pill that's glowing with the Shekinah glory of God, and that medicine is healing you as it travels through your mouth and down into your body. As it goes, it's pushing out all darkness, which is sickness and disease, and it's pushing it out from the inside out. Visualize the condition you're plagued with being on Jesus's body. Put whatever the ailments are on him. Use your imagination. You're not giving him something he doesn't want. He already took it at the cross, remember? The devil's trying to trick you, the enemy. He's trying to trick you. He's trying to trick you into taking it. How? By deceiving you into thinking you've got it through lying symptoms. But since Jesus took it at the cross, you're already healed and made whole. So put that lying symptom back on Jesus, right in the same place on him that you've been afflicted. In other words, see yourself without the problem. See yourself with the solution. This is called spiritual visualization. It's vital you understand it and do it. Now, if you've been diagnosed with a problem and are being treated by a doctor, then continue your treatment and medications, but add to it your faith and your taking of Holy Communion for healing and restoration. Now, the next thing we do in preparation is discern the blood of Christ. We discern it as the forgiveness of all sin, past, present, and future, as restoration of the blessing to your life, the power and the authority of God in your life in full operation, as receiving God's provision and protection, as receiving the gift of righteousness from Jesus Christ, thanking God for his plan of redemption, and that you've been included in it, that you have been given eternal life, life everlasting, and now you no longer live under the law, but you live under his grace. Now, lift up the elements of the covenant. These are the items I asked you to assemble at the beginning of the program. Lift them up before the Lord as I pray. Father, we praise you and worship you with these elements of the covenant. We thank you that your only begotten Son, Jesus, gave his life sacrificially so that we may live and have life more abundantly. We now thank you as this food item becomes our portion of his healing body and the vibrancy of his life within us. We thank you that as we partake of the body of Christ, we become healed and made whole, completely restored. We thank you that this beverage becomes our portion of his cleansing blood, that we are continually washed in the waterfall of his precious blood and renewed within as we continually remember his act of love on the cross on our behalf. In the name above all names, the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. You know, the Lord's Supper is a personal fellowship. It's a partnership with Christ, and partaking of one bread creates partnership between the members, the disciples, as well. It merges them into one body known as the church. The Word of God commands us to eat the bread and drink the cup. Continually take the bread, give thanks, and break it, and eat it. Then take the cup, give thanks, and drink it, all in the remembrance of Jesus. The Lord commanded that the supper be repeated often, and yet Paul doesn't give us instruction as to how frequently the Lord's Supper is to be celebrated. He does imply that it's to be done with frequency so that partaking of the Lord's Supper will continually recall to our mind our redemption by Christ from all sickness, all disease, and all sin. My friends, do it as often as you want to and need to. Remember, too, that you don't need a priest, nor do you need a minister or pastor to administer Holy Communion to you. We who are born again are members of the royal priesthood and therefore have been given the authority and right by God to administer Holy Communion to ourselves and others. Now, as we are instructed, we discern the body and the blood of Christ as we prepare to partake. On the night that he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we thank you that this item of food has become the bread of life, the healing body of our Lord Jesus the Christ. The body of our Lord Jesus broken for you so that every cell, every tissue, every organ and bone, all systems, neurological, blood vascular, lymphatic, muscular, skeletal, all systems are totally aligned with God's word and his will, that you are and remain healed, made whole and totally restored to divine health and wholeness. In the name of Jesus, our healer, the Christ, we pray. Amen. Partake of the body of our Lord and Savior. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Father, we thank you that this beverage has become our portion of the precious saving blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. The blood of our Lord Jesus shed for you in celebration of the finished work of Jesus on the cross for the remission of all your sins, past, present, and future, and for the restoration of the empowerment of God, the blessing in your life, and the gift of righteousness. In the name of Jesus, our Redeemer and Savior, the Christ, we pray. Amen. Partake of the blood of our Lord and Savior. The Lord's Supper is a feast, my friends, a feast in union with the believers and the living Savior, whereby we spiritually and by faith receive Christ with all of his benefits, and we're nourished with the vibrancy of his life into eternal life. And for that, my friends, we are eternally grateful. Did you receive this today? I pray that you did. If you need further explanation of the message or understanding of it, contact me. You can reach me at masterstouchhs@cox.net. That's masterstouchhs@cox.net. Now, from here, we go to Living the Word, broadcast to you every Monday now at 12 noon. You don't want to miss these broadcasts. They're going to impact your life. My friends, let me ask you a question. As a born-again believer, do you really know who you are in Christ? I mean, what does that really mean, being in Christ? Join my co-host, Dr. Sherry Thomas, and myself every Thursday morning at 9 a.m. Pacific time here on Spreaker.com for our program, Life in Christ. And we'll be taking you into the depths of what it means to be in Christ. You'll learn who you are, why you're here, what power you have, and then we're going to teach you how to use it. And you'll learn when to use it, too. And you'll learn who Christ is, not only as Savior and Redeemer, but his purpose here for you as your teacher as well. Be sure to join us for these broadcasts every Thursday at 9 a.m. Pacific time. You don't want to miss it. All right. Now, any program that we have, I want you to come to it. And when you do, come expecting to receive. For a full programming schedule, please visit our website homepage, themasterstouch.org. That's themasterstouch.org. Brethren, Proverbs 4:7 tells us wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. And with all of your getting, get understanding. That's what we're doing here. Seeking God and gaining God's wisdom. So make sure you keep him Lord of your life. Right now, I want you to understand that Holy Communion is a subsidiary of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International, a 501c3 organization. Have a blessed and wonderful week, my friends. We will see you here for Holy Communion on Monday mornings at 10 a.m. God bless you.